I'd like to thank the Fortuna Junior Academy for being here and for bringing us our special music today. I was out at the school. What a wonderful campus we have. What a wonderful group of young people. What a great staff you have at that school. And just some things I'm finding out. I've been going around this week. I had the privilege to be at Pathfinders, and what a wonderful program. You have a great leader there, and with wonderful help and a great group of young people there. And I was over at Community Services this week. Wow, I didn't know you had so much going on in this church. God has been really blessing in the ministries of this church, and I count it a privilege to be your new pastor. And I'm excited. You know, yesterday I was helping out at the setting up for the drive-through nativity. What an exciting time for this church to be able to reach out to the community. Well, it was great fellowship. A lot of work got done. And I can't wait till tonight. And I hope to see all of you there. All right? All right, today I want to talk about the wonderful counselor. I like to take a look at Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. If you turn your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6 with me, and I'd like to tell you a story about a young man. He was in college, and he was in his senior year, and he had to choose an elective. And he had heard about an old professor. He was very generous with his grades. He gave easy A's, and he taught a class on ornithology and the study of birds. And he thought, oh, this would be a fun class. And so he signed up for the class, only to find out on the first day when the class began that the old professor had retired and that there was a new professor, a young professor, and he was out to teach these kids everything about birds. And the class was just miserable. What he was hoping was an easy class, an easy A, and this class was, he had to go on field trips, he had to read books, he had to look up things on the internet, and he didn't want to do all that. He just wanted an easy class. And finally, the final exam kind of pushed him over the edge. He took a look at the final exam, and there were 25 pairs of bird legs. And he had to identify all 25 bird legs. And it just pushed him over the edge. And he threw his paper in the air, and he walked up to the teacher, and he had to give the teacher a piece of his mind. And he said, what are you doing? He says, nobody is going to use any of this information in this class after the class is done. This was to be a fun class, and you gave us all these tests and papers to do and things to read, and we don't care about all this. We'll never use any of this ever again. And the professor was kind of taken back. And the professor, he said to the young man, he said, who are you? And the young man thought about it for a second, and then he reached down, and he grabbed his pant legs, and he pulled them up to his knees, and he said to the professor, you figure it out. And he walked out of the class. Now, today I'm not just telling stories. Today, I want us to realize when it comes to Jesus Christ, God wanted us to know exactly who Jesus is. He wanted us to recognize his character. And therefore, in this book of Isaiah, 700 years before Jesus is born, God gives us a clear description of who Jesus is. He doesn't want us to guess at it. He doesn't want us to have to scratch our heads and try to figure it out. He wants us to know exactly what Jesus will be like. Here it is, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born. Yeah, this deals with the humanity of Jesus Christ. He's a child that is born. And unto us a son is given. For God so loved the world, He gave. He gave His only begotten Son. And this refers to the divinity of Jesus Christ. It says, and the government will be upon His shoulder, and His name will be called Wonderful. Oh, isn't that beautiful? To recognize Jesus, the first thing we have to realize is that He is wonderful. And something wonderful helps us to deal with the dullness of life. It's something beautiful. It's something unique. It's something that demands our attention. Something wonderful. I think of the little tiny flea. And you know, the little flea can jump over 200 times its own length. Now, if you and I were able to do that, we could jump over 1,200 feet. And we would make Michael Jordan and LeBron James look like little babies. A fly can walk 3 inches in a half a second, and if it was us, we could walk 20 miles in a minute. An ant can lift many times its own weight, and if we were to have the strength of an ant, we could lift a locomotive. Now, those things causes us to pause and to reflect. God had created such a wonderful world, and when we see Jesus, He's going to be wonderful. And indeed, He is wonderful. I mean, who has ever saw someone who could open the eyes of the blind, who cleansed the lepers, who cast out the demons, who could feed the multitudes, who could raise the dead? Jesus was indeed wonderful. To see Jesus, you have seen something wonderful. Something wonderful has depth. Something wonderful causes us to reflect. It has value. It enriches us. It brings out the very best in us. It motivates us to do our very best. It creates in us an attitude of humility, because when we see something wonderful, we know that there is something greater. There is someone who has planned this, someone who has designed this. When I think of that word wonderful, you know, it's used many times in the Bible. In the book of Samuel, in 2 Samuel 1:26, it talks about the love that Jonathan and David had for one another. It says that their love was wonderful. And as I thought about that, I realized that it wasn't just telling us about their own love, but that this is the kind of love that God has for you and me. He has a wonderful love, greater than the love that David and Jonathan had for one another. And not only that, but Jesus wants to live and reign in our hearts. And He wants to fill us with His love so that we can love others the same way. Wow! His love is wonderful. Jesus is wonderful. And the word wonderful is used in the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 9. And this is before Solomon is going to build the temple. It says the temple is going to be wonderful. And you think about that temple, and indeed it was a beautiful, it was a most incredible thing that was ever built at any time in human history. But that's what not made that temple wonderful. It wasn't the building itself. It was the fact that God was going to be present with His people. It was the fact that God filled that temple. That's what made the temple beautiful. And today, We become the temple of the Holy Spirit. And God wants to come into our lives. And just as that Old Testament temple that Solomon built was wonderful, with Jesus Christ in us, we can become wonderful too. Job, yeah, he went through lots of trials. He went through many hard times. Yeah, he lost everything. He lost his family, his children. He lost his health. He lost his wealth. And you know the story of Job. But as he comes to the end of the book, in Job chapter 42 and verse 3, Job talks about the wonderful knowledge of God. Regardless of what he had gone through, God came to Job in his darkest hour, and God spoke to Job. And Job could only think about God. He got his mind off of his trials and tribulations and all the hard things that he had gone through. And he put his mind on God, and then he realized how wonderful God is, even through his hard times. And today I know some of you are going through hard times. And I hope you experience the wonderful knowledge of God. I hope you see how wonderful Jesus Christ truly is. When we think of Christ, we can't help but think of something that is wonderful. Hey, turn with me to Matthew chapter 21. Take your Bibles, turn with me to the New Testament, and Matthew chapter 21. And verse 15. All right. Matthew 21, verse 15. Listen to the words. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he, referring to Jesus, that he did. See, Jesus did wonderful things. He did what no one else could do. It says here, and the children crying out in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant. Now it tells me that when we see something wonderful, and indeed Jesus was a wonderful person, he did wonderful things, we have a choice. We have a choice to make. Now, these religious leaders saw all the wonderful things that Jesus did, and they became indignant. They became angry. They were frustrated with Jesus, and they were going to plan to put an end to Jesus. But then there were other people. The children were there, weren't they? And they were praising Jesus. Now, today we have a choice. We can either praise Jesus or we can become indignant. And today, I don't want to be like those chief priests. I don't want to be like those Pharisees and scribes. I don't want to be like those religious leaders. Today, I want to be like those children who praise God for his goodness and mercy and grace. And I hope you do the same thing too. You know, Jesus was wonderful, and to know Jesus is to know that he is wonderful. And he changed people's lives. When you think about it, all his disciples, Peter, James, John, all of them, hey, we would have never have heard of them. What made the difference? Jesus came into their lives. And Jesus wants to come into your life. And he wants your life to become wonderful. I think of the greatest miracle that Jesus had ever done, and that was to turn the cross from a symbol of punishment into the sign of your salvation and my salvation. That was the greatest miracle that Jesus did. To know Jesus is to know that he is wonderful. And today, Jesus is reaching out to us, and he's speaking to us, he's calling to us, and he wants you to know that he is wonderful. And not only is he wonderful, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 tells us that he is to be a counselor. He's a wonderful counselor. And counselor helps us with the decisions of life. A counselor is important to us for two reasons. First of all, our hearts are deceitful. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 17, verse 9, it says, our hearts are deceitful and desperately wicked. We don't know our hearts, but praise God, Jesus does. And he's a wonderful counselor, and he can help us in our most hardest and difficult times. You know, I think of those disciples. And remember that they promised in that when they were in the upper room, when they were celebrating communion, that they were not going to forsake Jesus, that they were going to stick to him to the end, even if it meant their own lives. But in a few hours later, they all ran away. They didn't know their own hearts. And that's why we need someone that is our counselor, to lead us, to guide us, to help us to make the right decisions. When I was in the seminary, I remember H.M.S. Richards Jr. came to our seminary and spoke to us. And he said to us, when he was growing up, he was quite the character. After all, his dad was pretty famous. He was the director and leader of the Voice of Prophecy, and he was a well-known speaker all over the world. So he was getting away with things that ordinary kids wouldn't get away with. He was quite a character in an academy, and even in college, he was always pushing the limits. He was always getting into trouble with the pastors and with the teachers. And he really didn't want to do anything with God. What he really wanted to do, he played a musical instrument, and he wanted to be in a band. And he remembers coming home late one night. He was out playing his music, and finally early in the morning, he was coming home. And as he got to the house, he noticed that there was a light on in the garage. In the garage was where his dad had his library. And so he took a baseball bat from the back of his car, and he walked quietly into the house and to the garage. And he saw that there was a door open to the garage. And he heard some voices. And he wondered who would be in his dad's office at this time. And he heard the voice, and he wondered who would be talking. And he saw his dad kneeling down on the ground. And he thought, uh-oh, my dad's in trouble. But he had his baseball bat, and he opened the door up gently, and he looked around, and there was no one else in the room. And he was listening to his dad, and his dad was praying. And his dad was praying for him. And he couldn't believe it. And he was so touched. He realized he couldn't outrace his dad's prayers. He could outrace the pastors that were after him. He could outrace his teachers. But he couldn't outrun his dad's prayers. He gave his heart completely to Jesus Christ. He went over and he knelt down beside his dad. And he wept. And he decided he was going to join the ministry. And what a great man of God he turned out to be. You see, we need a counselor to help us make the right decisions, the most important decisions, and that decision is to follow Jesus Christ all the way. We need a counselor for two reasons, because our hearts are deceitful and because our minds are limited. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, and this morning we read it in our Sabbath school lesson, it talks about that God's ways are not our ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so God's thoughts are towards us. You see, we have limited knowledge, and God sees the end from the beginning. And God is the one who can lead us and guide us. I'm thankful today that when God revealed to Isaiah who Jesus would be, that he would be wonderful, that Jesus would be our counselor. I read a story this week about a physical therapist. He decided, after a successful work as a physical therapist, he had a good clientele and a good reputation, that he was going to go into the ministry. And his friends that had worked with him for years asked him, "Well, why are you doing this?" And he said to them, "Well, when I started as a physical therapist, we had one really sad case come in. It was a young boy who was in a terrible accident. And so I talked to doctors, and we did a surgery on his legs and arms and on his back, and we were able to straighten out his bones, and he was able to walk and run again like any normal child. And then there were the scars that were on his body and on his face, and we got all those removed." And then finally he said to his friends, he said to them, "And you know where this young man is today?" And they all shrugged their shoulders, said, "We don't know." He said, "They're in jail. This man is in jail." Hey, they couldn't believe it. They were shocked. And this physical therapist said, "You know, I aimed at changing this boy's body. I aimed at the outside, hoping to give him a chance in life. But I couldn't change the heart. I didn't aim for the heart. And there's only one person who can change the heart. And that's Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ can do what no other person can do, and that's why I want to be a minister. Today I'm grateful that Jesus is wonderful. Today I'm grateful that he's our counselor. And today I want you to notice that in the pew in front of you, there's a ministry card. And on this ministry card, it's a way for you to connect with the pastor, with the church office. And if there's anything that the church office can do for you, if you have any burdens, any prayer requests, have fill it out on that ministry card. But today, if you would like to know more about Jesus, if you want to know more about this wonderful counselor, just write me a note, and you can hand it to me on your way out. You can put it in the offering envelope, and I will contact you this week. Now is our time for our kneeling prayer, and I'm going to kneel, and if any of you, as far as possible, would like to unite with me in prayer, you're welcome to kneel, or you're welcome to sit in the pew there. Father and God, today we thank you and praise you for your Son, Jesus. Today we thank you that he is indeed wonderful, that he is our counselor. And Father, we open our hearts to you. We invite your presence into our lives. Please forgive us and cleanse us from any and all sin and unrighteousness, and fill us with your Holy Spirit. Clothe us in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And Lord, just help us day by day to reflect your character. Help us to become more like Jesus in all that we say, all that we do, all that we think, so that as other people see us, they will see you. Lord, I pray for each person here today. You know their heartaches, their struggles, their pain, their suffering. You know them better than I do. And Lord, I just place them all in your hands. I pray that you will lift them up to your throne of grace and minister to each one. I pray for their marriages. I pray for their homes, for their children. I pray that you will give them good health and that you will help them to prosper. I pray that you will bless them. Lord, you know that some of them have financial needs. You know that some of them are hurting physically. And Lord, I just pray for them and that you will minister to each one. I pray that you will bless this church and that you will bless the program tonight. I pray that there will be many people who will come from the community and not just witness the program, but that your Spirit will speak to their hearts. I pray for all the programs that are taking place in this community because of this church. I thank you and I praise you, Lord, for our school and for the young people who sung for us today. I pray that this school will just be a blessing. Bless our teachers and Lord, help our school to grow and be a light in this community. Lord, I pray for our young people that are in our Pathfinders program. I pray for the community services and the outreach there. Oh, Lord, continue to bless this church. And Lord, we long for that day when you will come again to take us home. Oh, come quickly, Lord Jesus. This we pray in your most precious and holy name. Amen.